Well, Hans, this is our second interview.
Here we are again.
Here we are again. Welcome. It took a while.
Thank you. Yeah, it did.
And to be honest with you, we did not decide to do the easiest subject possible.
No, delusion of grandeur, I'm afraid.
Okay.
A bit.
Okay. Because we're going to talk about the...
The zone system of Ansel Adams.
Yeah, and I'm very apprehensive. It's a large subject to discuss.
It's a very large subject, but you don't need to go in all the details to understand what it's all about. Mm-hmm. So you can, in broad lines, you can sketch the zone system and make it knowledgeable for almost anyone. So
even for me,
even for you, okay. And even for the viewers at home, it's not a big secret.
Right.
It's mostly a lot of practice and be accurate. And try to interpret the right way what you see in a picture.
Mm-hmm.
I got fed up with my quality of black and white pictures, and I started wondering why I didn't achieve the quality I was supposed to do, because I did everything right. I used a gray card for my exposure, and I did exactly everything that's on the box of the film, and I did everything exactly what was on the box of the developer. I kept to my degrees, so the temperature was right, and even though I did everything right, I still got those lousy pictures with black holes in the shadows and washed out white highlights. So,
You could actually say that your frustration at that moment more or less opened the door for the zone system.
Well, it opened the door to throw my camera away, because to be dead honest, before I listened to a lecture of somebody, it was some sort of a last resort. If this doesn't help me,
mm-hmm.
Well, it's just me, so I can't take pictures. So whatever, I will stop doing it.
Okay.
Because I was fed up with all those pictures with washed out highlights and black rabbit holes as shadows without any detail in them. And I couldn't figure out why that was.
Right.
Until I went to see that person. That was Mich Buschmann from a Dutch photo magazine that's called Focus. And he had a lecture in a photo festival in Naardenvesting, somewhere in the beginning of the 90s. I could be hard-pressed.
That's a while back.
That's a while back, yeah, yes. But yeah. He mentioned, within 5 minutes, he mentioned all my problems.
Did he also solve your problems?
Not yet, okay. But then he decided we should drink a cup of coffee first. So and all I could do is just sit there transfixed on that chair and couldn't wait until he started talking again. And then after that, then he started to offer resolutions for the problems and well, asking the right questions is
okay.
Actually more accurate than because what you see in a picture, it has a reason.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes if you see white on a black and white picture and that should have been some texture in it,
right,
you can say, well, it's overexposed. But is that the truth? Because you can also overdevelop. And that gets the same result in a way. And if you have a shadow detail in your picture, which is totally black, and when you were standing there taking the picture, you could see into that shadow. Did you underexpose,
mm-hmm.
or did you underdevelop? What's going on here?
Mm-hmm.
So. Asking you the questions and giving the right answers, that will effectively help you on the path to the zone system, because that is where the secret lies, in those questions.
Can you tell us, in short, what is the definition I have good questions for you.
Okay.
What do you see as a definition of the zone system?
The definition of the zone system is by pre-visualization, knowing, not guessing, knowing what will be in your picture after you developed and printed it. So that you know what your picture will look like after you went into the darkroom.
Right.
And it's not guessing, but knowing. And the pre-visualization is one of the biggest things Ansel teaches us. And it's hard, it's a drag. Because you have to pre-visualize all your different gray tones in your picture already, and then you have to put them in a scale from 0 to 10, because the zone system has 10 faces from black to white. And if you can put your image into those zones, then you can figure out what is your zone 5, which is your middle zone, and then you can measure your contrast. And if that's in a certain headroom, then you know that your picture will come out
right
the way you see it.
Every photographer knows Ansel Adams.
I'm afraid so, yes.
Yeah. What is his association to the zone system?
Well, he more or less developed it. He wrote 3 books about the zone system. 3 lively books. And it's the camera, which is important, but not as important. Then, to be dead honest, this is my Bible, because this is the negative.
Right.
This is where you put all the information in your negative in a way that you can print it. And obviously the last one is the print, which is also very important. But if you do this the right way, this is easy.
Okay.
More or less easy.
But nowadays everybody's taking photos with digital cameras.
Sure.
And nerds like us, and also watching this YouTube channel, you know, we love film.
Yeah.
But is this also applicable to digital photography?
In every way. Now we have to scoop a bit to what Ansel tells us, and that is we should expose for the shadows and develop for the highlights. And in a way, you can do that with digital also, because what you can do, you can pay more attention to your darker parts of your picture. And if you work in RAW, which you should, then you can temper your highlights with your RAW converter or Lightroom. So if you do that, then you get payback by your camera, because if you overexpose your shadow slightly, there will be less noise. So your darker spots will have more and vibrant detail in it. And your highlights you can remove, but you can temper them with your highlights and white buttons. So yes, it's very much applicable to digital. It's not only for with the color film, not so much. But as I told you in the preview, the development of color film is one process.
Right.
And you don't have any influence on the time.
Exactly. Yeah.
But there is one thing you have with color film, and that is you have a lot of headroom before your pictures are blown out white. So you can also pay more attention to your shadows, overexpose slightly more. You get, as a present, you get slightly more saturated colors, less grain in the shadows, and your highlights will still be okay. So yes, you can still do it.
Okay. It's all about practice. Practice.
Yes.
But it's also about focus and it's about precision.
And it's about frustration.
Oh, why?
Because you get fed up, because I got fed up with pictures like this. I've been into my back catalogue of my negatives to find pictures I never printed, because I already knew when I saw them in my enlarger, the pictures weren't not very great.
Mm-hmm.
And things like, for instance, now this one is bad. The sky is all white, and if you look here, the shadow information is going almost black, and I measured here on a gray card, so I knew I didn't know what zone 5 was, but mm-hmm. I knew where my zone 5 was, and I did everything exactly by the book. And still I got those nasty washed out whites and almost totally black shadows, and I was fed up with it. And like this, for instance, here it's all dark, and I did everything exactly right. And so if you are frustrated like I was,
mm-hmm.
and you want to get a result from this, to get a better result than this, you have to pay attention.
Mm-hmm.
Because I can help you, we can help you get better results than this. Because, okay, here we go. I'm going to ask you a question. I think you know the answer, but if your highlights are washed out, what does that mean? That's one of the questions you have to ask yourself. What does it mean?
Well, the first thing I would say is that you overexpose your photo.
Sure, but I just told you.
Mm-hmm.
I measured on a gray card.
Mm-hmm.
So I know that my middle gray was okay. So why did my highlights washed out completely?
Then it has to do with your development.
Yeah, sure. I overdeveloped.
Mm-hmm.
And I overdeveloped by quite a lot, about 15% or something.
Mm-hmm.
And then the other question, and this picture is even better for that. If you look at the shadows here, there's almost no detail anymore here in the water. And I can show you a picture later on when I show you how you do it and how it can look. But what does that tell you? Because these are the questions that really count. What does it tell you if you don't have any... and there goes the Sony. If there's no detail in your shadows, what does it tell you?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it tells you that the sensitivity in your film is not enough to make the details pop. So the box speed of this film is HP5 from Ilford.
Mm-hmm.
It says 400, but it's not a lie. But in normal practice, it's not 400 ASA.
Right.
Not in this situation, maybe in a laboratory, yes, but in a slightly more contrasty environment, 400 speed is not reached.
Mm-hmm.
So it's underexposed. So what do you do to solve that? That's to overexpose slightly to get that image back.
Right.
And then obviously, yeah, but what happens to my highlights? They were already very white, and if I'm going to overexpose,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
it even gets worse.
Yeah.
Well, you can compensate by developing shorter, and you have to develop quite a lot shorter before your shadows suffer. So you can go up to 30-35% shorter before your shadows will suffer. So you can overexpose slightly for your shadows and underdevelop for your highlights, and then you get those two together, and then you can reach something like, for instance, the same picture as this one, then you can reach like this, and now you can see that my highlights, even it's probably not on the on the computer, not visible, but there's slightly marbling here from the clouds.
Yeah.
But if you look at the difference in the shadows, it's the same picture,
yeah.
really. And
it's a major difference.
Yeah. Yeah. To give you an example of a picture I took, I think I was taking pictures for maybe 2 years or something. And I can't even remember why I took this picture, but it's a picture of a sign, perhaps on Queen's Day, that you can throw eggs at people. And you can throw 5 eggs for 5 guilders or 12 eggs for 10 guilders onto someone. And I took this picture, and I know by heart that the sky was blue with white clouds. And I thought that would be a nice picture. Mm-hmm. So I took my gray card, took my measurement, made the picture, and when I got home, I put the negative into my enlarger, and I already saw that the black of the film, what should be the white on the picture, mm-hmm. was so dense that it was impossible to take a good picture of it. So I never printed this up until 2 weeks ago. And what you see here is a totally white background and a good sign. Because it wasn't a white sign, it was a gray sign. So that's okay, but my shadows are completely black. Okay, it's opposing light, but still it's completely black. So that is what you get if you do exactly what's on the box, mm-hmm. on the boxes, and the box of the film and the box of the developer, for instance. If you know somewhat more about the zone system, you can achieve more or less the same picture, same angle from downstairs upwards, and now with also a blue sky and white clouds and a gray subject. Mm-hmm. But because I developed less, I think about 15 or 20%, and I overexposed the film by 2/3 stop, like 250 speed, except instead of 400. Now I have my shadows open. I have my clouds up until the most bright white here, and the blue in the sky is very realistic. So right. What you see is what you get.
Right.
And that should be your goal if you take pictures, that what you see is what you eventually get on your picture, so that what struck you in a scene, and everything in a scene is even important, mm-hmm. Because that helps to create the atmosphere of the picture. That's why you took the picture. Because if you have a picture like this, because the sky was more or less the same like this, if you try to superimpose this sky on this picture, you will have a very much more nice picture to look at.
Right.
Instead of this. So this is what I saw, and my hope was that it would turn out the same like this.
Well, that's interesting what you just say, because the zone system enables you to register on film what you see with your own eyes.
Well, that's
or you come close.
That's yeah. The whole purpose.
Exactly.
The whole purpose is that what you see with your eyes, mm-hmm. you can translate to paper.
Right.
And you can go relatively far with, you can even go too far. We all know in the day and age of digital what HDR means, right? Mm-hmm. I don't know if, I think it's horrible because it's yeah. way over the top.
It's unnatural.
It's unnatural, yeah. But if you over-exaggerate the zone system, you can achieve HDR on a film if you like. Mm-hmm. You can make your highlights as dark as your shadows, for instance, and you don't have any contrast left. It's like an FM radio station with all the compressors full on, so you hear nothing of the silent parts, and the loudest parts are almost the same. So you get one smear of an audio image. But you can do that with pictures too.
Right.
If you equalize the highlights and the shadows up until, well, one or two stops perhaps, mm-hmm. well, then it becomes surreal, unrealistic. The goal of the zone system is to get you on the right track, to get as good as an image as you possibly can on paper. And for instance, this one I took in one of my strolls in the early morning, walking from my house to the store during the first lockdown.
Right.
This I took with my Leica M2, and this was a scene. It's a liquor store, which was converted to just a normal home. But they kept the whole facade of the shop the same, and I don't know, because you will superimpose it in the film.
Yeah.
But you can even see that the glass here, you got some lens working here, and even the more brighter parts of the sun, it's there.
Yeah.
And and your shadows are open, and it's a very pleasant picture to look at.
Now that I look at it a second time, because you showed me it before we do this video, it's almost a 3D effect. It's strange. It looks like there's much more depth in your image.
Well, the same, the opposite is true of HDR.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at the dynamic range pictures, they're flat as a pancake.
Right, right.
You don't see any depth because there is no contrast. And you have to keep in account that in photography, we don't have 3D. Well, we can have if you take stereoscopy in account. But with normal picture taking, we only have the picture. You don't have something that creates the depth,
right.
So we have to suggest depth, and you can do that with contrast.
Well, you've achieved that in this photo.
Yes. Well, it's if everything is on the right spot, and this one is particularly nice for as an example,
mm-hmm.
what you can achieve if you really pay attention.
Mm-hmm.
And it's hard in the beginning, it's a drag,
mm-hmm.
but if you put yourself behind it and you really try to see how you how less you develop and how more you overexpose for your shadows, then you can achieve brilliant things you wouldn't even considered possible,
mm-hmm.
In black and white photography, fully open lights like this, for instance. This is an opposing light, a very harsh opposing light picture,
mm-hmm.
and the shadows are open and the highlights are open. I even achieved to get the back of my daughter with some detail.
Right.
This will be zone 9, and this. This is what you can achieve, and if you really try your best, it's not even that hard.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes, after a while, it becomes second nature.
Now I'm going to ask you a question that we did not prepare.
Okay.
So, see what kind of an answer I can get. Maybe it's a stupid question.
No, there's no such thing.
That's what I wanted to hear.
I'm
just thinking, you're saying you have to take your time, but for example, street photography, there's
mm-hmm.
also a split moment, a candid moment, quick photography.
Mm-hmm.
Can you also imagine there that you could take this type of technique, the zone system, into account?
Yeah, absolutely. Because the only thing you have to do is take one measurement of the scene, and as long as you're walking the same direction of the
mm-hmm.
street,
mm-hmm.
you can keep your same aperture and your same shutter speed. Because
right.
if the light doesn't change, your camera doesn't need to change.
Right.
Because what you want to have on your negative is how much or how little your subject reflects light.
Mm-hmm.
So if you take a measurement and there is, for instance, someone in a black coat coming by, you don't have to alter your exposure because you want that coat to be black. So leave it that way. Although you have perhaps a sense of, now I'm going to really underexpose this.
Mm-hmm.
But if it's a very black coat, you don't have to see any details in it, or just only a tiniest bit. The opposite is true also. If you walk, it may happen here in Haarlem near the Grote Markt. If you're taking pictures over there and you're just pointing your camera in more or less the same direction, and a bride comes to the town hall to get married, and you take a picture of a beautiful woman in a white dress. Well, you don't have to change your camera because that dress is going to reflect an enormous amount of light.
Right.
Well, that's going to be black on your negative, and that's the meaning of it, right?
Okay.
So you don't have to change it. So for street photography, yes, very much so.
Okay.
Very much so. Only if you what I do, I take three measurements: opposing light, with the sun in my back, and with the sun from the side.
Mm-hmm.
And usually it's something like one or two stops difference.
Mm-hmm.
And the only thing I do if I turn, I open my my shutter speed one stop, and then I'm good to go.
Right.
As as long as the light doesn't change,
mm-hmm.
you don't have to change your camera. You can go for hours on end without changing your camera as long as the sun is the light is stable.
Yeah,
it's another thing if you have overcast partly overcast with sun and clouds, sun and clouds, but then still you can wait until the cloud is complete, and then you take a measurement, and then you know the difference between the sun and the cloudy circumstances.
Right.
And the only thing you have to do is click your shutter speed more open for the cloudy circumstances than for the sunny circumstances. And as long as you know the difference,
yeah,
you're home free.
This brings us to the other point that we discussed, that the exposure is the most crucial element. It's your starting point in the process.
Yes.
So the registration of a correct exposure is crucial.
Yeah, if that goes wrong, you're lost.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to say.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah,
then you're
that's
lost.
How easy it is.
That's
it.
That, yes.
Yeah.
Because if you underexpose for instance one stop,
mm-hmm.
then you have lost your shadow information, and you can't get that back.
Yeah.
You can try to develop longer, but that will your highlights will suffer. This, for instance, it's not so much, it's only about 10 or 15% too long development that causes the whole highlight situation to be white.
Right.
It's not so much.
Yeah.
This is the difference between nominal
mm-hmm.
and 15% less.
Yeah.
That's enormous.
Yeah, that's unbelievable. Yeah. I'm just having a look if I might have one or two questions left, because this part one of the zone system, because we mentioned it's a large subject,
we
was
have
more
to go
or less
into the digital technical details.
Yeah. So this was more or less meant to give a flavor for what we're talking about and to give some examples. So I do still have maybe one or two questions for you.
Well, fire it up.
Because we talked about pre-visualization.
Mm-hmm.
That's a terrible word to pronounce.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to do it a second time. But what is meant by that?
The short version is what you do with pre-visualization is that you look at your subject and you try to visualize where your different details will be, where your shadows will be, where your midtones will be, where your highlights will be, and try to measure how far apart they are.
Mm-hmm.
And in the next program, we're going to show you how it's divided into 10 zones, or sometimes in 8.
Mm-hmm.
If you pre-visualize correctly, you can more or less see what you're going to get, and if you measure the contrast between your darkest subjects in your picture and your lightest subject in your picture, and it's all within a given range,
yeah,
then you know for sure that it will fit.
Right.
and that your picture will come out the way you saw it,
mm-hmm.
the way you pre-visualized it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's important for the pre-visualizing part, because if you don't pre-visualize correctly, you can't, for instance, take a picture like this.
Yeah.
And because the difference between the darkest part here and the lightest part here, I can be mistaken one or two stops, but it was like 11 or 12 stop difference between this part and that part. And this one was an assignment. So
and you still have details in the shadows?
Yeah, and there's still details in the highlights.
Yeah.
And this is almost impossible to do with a digital camera even, because there's so much difference.
Yeah.
It's very hard to in your raw converter to get this back with your highlights and your whites, but with film you can.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to, you have to measure, you have to calculate and calculate and calculate. I had to drop the sensitivity of my film, and I'm known for using the HP 5, so that's 400 speed, and this one, I thought it was like 64. Speed. I used it, and I developed it 50% shorter than
50-50.
Yeah.
So 50
is the half time. Yeah. So normally it's like 6.5, and this was like 3.15 minutes.
Right.
To take this picture, because you do want to have this, so you have to overexpose your shadows a lot, but you have to underdevelop to get this. Right, mm-hmm. Because if you develop too long, this will get whiter and whiter and whiter,
yeah,
and you
yeah.
can't get it all right. And the grade I want to print in the darkroom is like 2.5. That's my goal. And then, you manage to achieve this, and you can get even further. I think I never tried it. Because I was quite happy with this, and I left it.
Well, I still have two questions, and then we finish part one.
Okay.
One is, and that was so interesting to hear from you, you mentioned choose a film, choose a developer, and stick with it.
Sure.
Why?
Okay, well, first, at the start, you need to experiment with different combination, right? Just to see which film is speaking to you, mm-hmm. and which combination of film and developer is working best for you. As soon as you find that,
mm-hmm.
stick to it.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you can experiment if you find a new kind of film and you're very curious. Well, go ahead. But if that's not a big difference with what you had, go back to your old combination, because if you do that and you start with the zone system, then you get really a good thinking of what the film is doing in combination with that developer, and you know and learn all the quirks of the film,
mm-hmm.
and also what its possibilities are, but also impossibilities are of the film, and as soon as you know them, you can work around them.
Mm-hmm.
And if you jump from one film to the other, you will have a general knowledge of those films, but
mm-hmm.
you don't have an in-depth knowledge of that film. So you won't be able. I won't be able. But for instance, I love to take pictures with the Acros film from Fujifilm, but I don't know it for real. So if I had to take this picture with an Acros film,
mm-hmm.
I would be hard pressed. I don't think I can do it.
Okay.
I need to make those photos first to see what's the latitude of the film, what's the headroom, what can I achieve if I go all berserk with the zone system. Where do I get this? And then if you have that set of tools, then you can make this.
Mm-hmm.
But only then. So with a strange film, I wouldn't be able to make this.
Okay. Last question for you.
Sure.
If people want to work with a zone system and they take that into account when they make the exposure, they don't necessarily have to develop their own film at home.
No, it's not.
They can bring it to a lab or to you, for example, which
yes.
I do, and you know.
I would advise to do it yourself.
Why is that?
Because every link in the chain is important.
Mm-hmm.
So if you are developing your film yourself and you have found a way to be very accurate, you can make slight adjustments to what I can't do for you, because I don't know what kind of pictures you took. So what happens to me if I develop my own films is that I'll be thinking about my pictures on the film, and I'm, that picture, that would be nice, but it was very harsh contrast. So if I do 15% less, perhaps my highlights will be still a bit too black. So why don't I take 18 off, then the 3% extra short will not damage the other pictures. You see, so that these are all considerations you can do if you have
even
your
while
own,
you're in your while development process.
Yes.
Yeah.
So you can tweak.
Yeah.
Much better than I can do.
Yeah, I understand.
But you can get in the ballpark. Absolutely. Yeah. As soon as you have been thinking about your films and you say, Hans, could you please take 15 or 20% off? Well, no problem.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's good, and sometimes maybe not so good. It depends on how good your own guesstimation was.
Right.
But you will dial in enough exposure on your pictures for the next time you bring your film and you ask me, and then you find, and that's that nice word, an equilibrium.
Okay. Yeah.
You will find a way of exposing your film and me having developed it, because I'm a constant, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you're the variable.
Mm-hmm.
So if you dial that in so that you're on the same level, then the quality will be darn good, and you can print everything. It's no problem.
Interesting.
But it's very important to keep the chain as strong as possible. And you can do that by developing yourself. And if you don't have any courage to do that, well, it's no problem. Then I can do it for you, or another lab that has because you have to ask, are you capable of fine tuning your development with your machine? Because not all machine can do that.
Right. Okay. What a subject matter this is.
It's very interesting. It's a can of worms.
Yeah, I wrote down, I'm old school, so I write everything down, and I had pages full of questions that we haven't even had half the questions. Well, that was the whole intention, just to give a sort of an introductionary feel to the zone system. And are you up to a second part?
Sure.
With more technical details?
Sure.
And then I'll have you do a lot of talking and explaining.
Next week.
And I'll be learning also. Next week, I don't know.
Oh, then do it. We'll see.
I have to prepare this.
Oh, sure.
But I want to thank you again.
You're welcome.
Because it's always good fun to talk to you. And everybody learns from you. And thanks again. I appreciate it.
Hey, you're welcome.
Yeah. And we look forward to seeing you. And of course, Hans, together with Hans, in part 2. So thanks for watching.
Bye-bye.
Bye.